It's important to us that we be able to share information with the community whenever we can reasonably do so to help put the community at ease. The threat here is over. However, we are going to continue to be vigilant in our schools and in our neighborhoods to be present and to be alert for the situations that could, you know, create harm to our community. And in light of that, I want to talk about the importance of being aware. The old saying of see something, say something, whether it be a family member, a neighbor, a student, a peer. If you're aware of an individual who appears to be suffering from some kind of mental illness or distress, and they begin speaking about purchasing firearms or causing harm to others, we encourage you to reach out to somebody and to report that so that we can get help to that individual. It's important that all of us be engaged so that we can try to intercede as early as possible in a person's life to try and prevent a tragedy from occurring. This morning, we want to. I don't have any additional information on the status of the victims. We're not aware of any of them having been released since yesterday, those who were admitted. As we find out as they're released, we'll let you know. But I would like to do is share some of the images of the weapon that was used by the suspect. I know yesterday one of the questions was, how many weapons did the suspect use or have in his possession at the time of the incident? And we know now that he had in his possession one rifle, an AR-15 style rifle, a .223 caliber. I think we've got an image of that that we can put up for you. So this is, I'll step out of the way. This is the rifle the suspect brought into the school and used. Note that first time I saw it large, there is no forward handguard on that rifle, which is unusual. See the gas tube going back there. The suspect, in addition to the rifle, brought in a large quantity of ammunition. He had 7 magazines of ammunition on a chest rig that he wore. He also had an additional 8 magazines of ammunition in a field bag that he had carried. Now, this doesn't include the number of magazines that he left and dumped on the stairway in the corridors along the way. But it appears that he came into the building with more than 600 rounds of ammunition on his person. One of the other questions that came up yesterday, was there a manifesto that was left? When the FBI had gone through the vehicle that had been parked there that he used to drive to the school, there was some paperwork in it. The detectives had gone through much of it last evening. There was a document that he had created, handwritten, and in there he spoke about his desire to engage in this incident, to conduct this school shooting. I'll read one portion from that notebook in which he had written. He wrote, quote, "I don't have any friends. I don't have any family. I've never had a girlfriend. I've never had a social life. I've been an isolated loner my entire life. This was the perfect storm for a mass shooter," end quote. So in reading this, we could see, you know, some of what's going on inside his mind. He feels isolated, he feels alone, quite possibly angry and resentful of others who have what appeared to him to be healthy relationships, and so a desire to lash out. So this goes back to what I spoke about earlier, the critical importance of all of us being engaged with our family members, with our peers at work or at school or in our neighborhood, because when we're more engaged with one another, we're more aware of what each person is going through, we can do what we can to try and seek help for them, even if that's just reporting it to authorities. At this time, I believe the mayor would like to say a few words.
Thank you, Chief. Good morning. Last night I attended a vigil in Tower Grove Park with more than 100 people who gathered to honor the victims of yesterday's tragedy. They shared a wide range of emotions: frustration, anger, grief, and others felt impassioned to do more for their community. But even for those who didn't feel the need to stand up and speak, I know that tragic incidents like this can traumatize our youth, our children, our teachers, and the larger community. Let me be absolutely clear. The scourge of gun violence that continues to claim the lives of our children and families in their communities is a national emergency. It's a public health crisis that requires federal action. But at the local level, we want our community members to know that they are not alone. If you're experiencing trauma or other mental health concerns, or just need someone to talk to about this, you can for free by calling BHR's 24/7 365 helpline and Youth Connection helpline. You can dial 988, or you can call, if you're a young person and want to talk to someone, you can call 314-819-8802. Or you can text BEHEARD, BHEARD, or 31658. In addition, I want to reiterate my sincerest appreciation for the police officers, the fire department, our school security, school staff, and others that responded quickly without hesitation. Some parents, like myself, woke up this morning wondering if it's safe to send their children back to school in St. Louis. My son woke up around 1:30 this morning to call me from upstairs instead of coming downstairs. That's what kids do nowadays. Because he needed to talk. And as a mother, you try to reassure your children, reassure your child that everything's going to be okay. And I honestly felt like the safest place and the best place for him today was to go back to school, to be with school counselors who are going to be there to help him process, his teachers that care about him and the staff that care about him. But unfortunately, mass shootings have happened in almost every corner of our country. Suburban schools in Columbine and Parkland, a rural community in Uvalde. Because of this grim reality, the St. Louis Police Department, St. Louis Public Schools, our charter schools, and the Mayor's Office of Children, Youth, and Families have been conducting frequent trainings on how to respond to emergency situations like what we experienced yesterday. Trainings and active shooter drills are essential to ensuring that they responded as quickly as they did. And now I'd like to introduce Dr. Michael Brown, Deputy Superintendent of Student Support Services for St. Louis Public Schools. Thank you, Dr. Brown.
Good morning. At this time, we are supporting our school and the community. This morning, we activated three different resources. We have an in-person site for our two schools. We also have a virtual site that we email to those schools, staff, students, and parents as well. And we also increased our resources that we have online. If you go to slps.org, there's a mental health tab that will direct you to many of our resources that we use, that our students use, and that our staff use. So at this time, we are working on a long-term plan. We're collaborating with our community partners, as well as the mayor's office and the U.S. Department of Education. So we're working at this time to really come up with a next steps long-term plan for what we're about to count.
You're looking at a press conference in downtown St. Louis held by St. Louis Metropolitan Police, Mayor Tashara Jones, as well as officials from St. Louis Public Schools. A lot of people asked yesterday about the style of gun and how much ammunition that the suspected shooter had.
Where we, alongside of them, were engaged in an active shooter training that took place about a month and a half ago. And from that training, a lot of the things that the officers exhibited yesterday
What are the things that we learned during that session? We continue to have those ongoing sessions with our people, despite the fact that we know that we're in that space. So these are some of the things that we've been initiating and putting in place. Dr. Brown talked about long-term. The goal for us is to try to make schools as safe as possible, but to make sure that we're prepared for whatever comes to those buildings. So officers were aware of what happened, understood the magnitude of what was happening, but we were also prepared for what was happening.
Can you give your name?
I'm sorry, DeAndre, D-E-A-N-D-R-E, last name Davis, D-A-V-I-S. And I'm the Director of Safety and Security for St. Louis Public Schools.
All right, we'll open it up for questions.
Can you tell us where the suspect was shot inside the school? What room?
So that would be on the third floor, a room adjacent to the library. I don't know the room number offhand, but it was on the third floor.
Can you confirm for us the gun show where he tried to buy this gun? And then the private dealer, what do you know about that? Who was that? And will there be any kind of recourse for that sale?
Sure. So we're not going to talk a lot about those particular types of items because there's an ongoing investigation. We're partnered, of course, with the ATF looking into those matters. So, but there is an ongoing investigation. We've been able to develop quite a bit of information, and we need to pursue that. That's going to take a little bit of time.
What are your thoughts, though, on the fact that he's able to buy this from a private dealer and try to sell?
So, in generally speaking, when you go to a firearms dealer, there's a background check that's done. It's possible to do an individual sale. There are some loopholes in the law which they're referred to, and what that does is it removes any backstop that might have existed that would have prevented someone from getting a firearm when they should not have had it, whether they be a convicted felon or a person with a mental health issue. So I think it's important that we have background checks whenever anybody buys a firearm so that we can ensure that that backstop isn't removed, because that's a hindrance to ensure the safety of the community as a whole.
Is that what happened in this situation, or did he buy the
I was just speaking in general terms. In this particular case, ma'am, we're going to go through our investigation, make a determination as to what happened, and if we're able to proceed with any criminal charges, we'll do that.
You said he had no priors, but did he have juvenile priors?
So that's all closed record, everything related to juvenile.
Based on the level of ammunition, how impactful was it that you had more than the number of officers in that area?
Yeah, it was critical. You know, the 600 rounds is a lot of ammunition. If I don't know if anybody's a shooter or not, but it doesn't take long to burn through a magazine as you're looking down a long corridor or up or down a stairwell or into a classroom. This could have been a horrific scene. It was not, by the grace of God. And that the officers were as close as they were and responded in the manner that they did, coordinating not only with the school officers, but with EMS, our dispatch center. Everybody worked well together. We've trained in this before. As you've heard, I went through our active shooter class about a month ago, but everybody in our department goes through it. We do it about once a year. It's good to have that reinforced. I was speaking to a commander this morning, and one of the best parts about it is when we sign up for the class, you're not signing up, you know, as your entire unit or squad. You're just signing up with other random officers from across the city. So you may not even know who they are when you go through your training, which worked out well here, because we had officers from a number of different districts, a number of different specialized assignments, who may not even have known one another. But because of the training, they all knew what needed to be done. They created their teams, and they went in and they took action.
Excuse me. Sure. You had said yesterday it was a little unclear what happened at the point of entry, whether those security guards were armed. So I'd like to ask Mr. Andre Davis, the Director of School Security, could you tell us what's known at this time about at that checkpoint where he got in, some of the students said the security guards only had nightsticks or flashlights. Are these security guards, were they armed with guns to stop this sort of thing from even starting?
So he did not enter a checkpoint?
Yeah, so he was not on the helicopter.
Okay.
Get that.
Understood.
Yeah, thank you.
He did not enter a checkpoint?
The officers are not, that are stationed in schools, are not armed. The officers who respond to calls to schools are armed. We have about 25 officers that are armed with St. Louis Public Schools, but the ones that are stationed inside of buildings are not armed.
And in light of this,